Hey everyone, it's Matt over at Mount Pleasant Library. Today, as promised, I'm going to talk about Ready Player 2. The last time I did a sci-fi review, it was Ready Player 1, which is one of my favorite books, mainly because I think of all the pop culture references that I related to, as Ernest Cline, the author, and I are about the same age, and a lot of the stuff I related that he wrote about, I related to. I'm surprised that a lot of younger people also like the book, even though they would probably have to Google all those pop culture references in the first one. The second one, I think he scaled back on the pop culture, mainly because I think he had already talked about Steven Spielberg about making a sequel film. So I'm thinking that the properties that he kind of limited the amount of intellectual properties that they would have to license. So I think there was not as much of that in this book, but it still managed to be an interesting book. I was surprised that a lot of the reviews were pretty lukewarm for this. Lukewarm to bad. It does kind of start off with a lot of like quick pop culture allusions to things that reference to the action that's going on in the story, but then that kind of dies down once the story gets rolling, once the actual story of the book gets rolling. So I think it's not so bad. I think it might have been a little off-putting for the first part of the for the first like two chapters of the book, really, but for some people. Because he's alluding to a lot of things like Max Headroom and a lot of obscure 80s culture that again, may be of limited appeal. But when you get into the meat of the story, the focus this time is partially on the love triangle between. So James Halliday was the inventor of the Oasis. He passed away, as did his love interest, Keira Underwood. Who unfortunately didn't marry him. She married his friend Ogden Morrow, who was another Oasis inventor. And if you don't remember from the first story, the Oasis is the virtual reality world. So this explores a little bit of their love triangle, some in further detail. So the story starts out where shortly after Wade has won the rights to the Oasis, and he's pretty much become the CEO of the company that maintains the Oasis. And after doing that, he soon discovers that James Halliday had another secret of a special headset that allows the user to experience the Oasis like reality. So it's indistinguishable. So when you're in the Oasis, it's indistinguishable from the real world for you, even though these amazing things go on in there. You won't be able to tell. It also allows you to share memories and stuff like that, so people can live vicariously through other people using that headset. So it becomes super popular. There were some risks to it, and they were afraid that people would become too addicted to the Oasis. Already that was a trending as the world was falling apart, the real world and the story was kind of falling apart. I think also for long-term exposure, it can do some like brain damage, so there was a little concern about people using it too long. So after the headset becomes a hit, they have to go on another quest. What happens is there's an AI avatar of James Halliday called Anorak that kind of goes rogue. And he was kind of his assistant assisting Wade in the first book. In this book, he is teamed up with the his arch nemesis, Nola Sorrento, who killed some of Wade's family in the first book, and he was the CEO of IOI, which was a company, a rival software company that wanted to take over the Oasis and make it, you know, a profit machine for them. But unfortunately, Wade had beat them out. So Nolan Sorrento's looking for revenge. Anorak has, so he teams up with Anorak, who allows him to do this. But Anorak has a quest for Wade to go on, something that he's interested in. I won't give away too much for spoilers, but so he has another quest where he has to collect these crystals that will achieve Anorak's goal. So in this story, the pop culture references are kind of limited to just allusions, except for, okay, there were three main focuses for and this is following Keira Underwood's interest, I think, more than so they're a little different than from the first movie. And again, I think a lot of this is done, or from the first book, sorry, a lot of this is done to, again, because they're thinking of making it into a movie again, so they're limiting the number of intellectual properties that they have to buy rights to. So in the first part of the quest, they encounter a world where it's always a John Hughes movie is integrated into reality. So they have to rewrite a scene in Pretty in Pink to get the first crystal. And so it goes, so they're in a couple of John Hughes movies. I think it's Pretty in Pink and Ferris Bueller's Day Off and some others that are referenced there, but I think it's mostly those two, if I remember correctly. Once they change the, maybe it's also 16 Candles, I don't know. Once they change the ending, they're Pretty in Pink, they achieve the first quest. Then it's on to a planet where there's a Prince avatar. So Prince, you know, and the artist formerly known as Prince, who passed away recently. So it may be why he was included in this. Here's where I kind of part company with the author. I'm not a huge fan of Prince. About maybe like five or six songs that I like by Prince, and then that's about it. But this has a lot of Prince trivia. And they have to sort of, it's like a video game where they have to go up against different versions of Prince, I guess, throughout his career. And so they make it kind of interesting and fun. And they include Morris Day, who was an associate of Prince, another musician, who was somewhat associated with Prince. So it was kind of fun. And then the final quest, looking for in a Tolkien universe, which kind of makes sense with the Peter Jackson movies being so popular recently, that they did the last part is Tolkien. But overall, as far as the only obscure reference that they mentioned briefly is there's a world where it's like an educational TV world for kids, and there's some reenactments from or they're watching The Great Space Coaster, which was a late 70s kid show that I remember and was kind of fond of. Overall, I thought this was pretty good. I was surprised that the reviews were mixed. I think overall the story was kind of fun and kept the reader engaged, and is certainly worth reading. I hope there'll be a Ready Player 3 in the future. I can't guarantee these things. And as far as my other review, I think I covered the other interesting cyberpunk novels. The only other book that I think may be kind of related that I could mention is Robert Sawyer's Terminal Experiment, which I think exists in audiobook in Hoopla and cloud library if you use either of those services. You get the audiobook. If you need the physical book, you'd have to get that from the library. There's no ebook version, unfortunately. But Terminal Experiment was kind of a different. Terminal Experiment is kind of different. It was a Nebula award-winning novel, by the way, by Robert Sawyer. And it's where a guy has his brain copied, and unfortunately while he's having his brain copied, he's also thinking about his wife who had an affair with someone, and so one of the AI copies uses the internet to go after the wife, basically. So the AI kills the boyfriend, and then the woman's father for some reason. And there's three different copies. One thinks it's immortal. One thinks he's the actual person. And I forget what the difference is with the third one. But they have to figure out which one is the killer. So that's kind of, and the reasoning behind it. So that's kind of the fun part of the story. So Terminal Experiment was written in the 90s, I believe, and it's set in 2010. And he does predict Uber Eats, but other than that, I think he gets a lot of the media stuff, like Phil Donahue's still working in 2010, which I think he was retired by then. So, I mean, a lot of things he gets wrong, but it's funny, he got Uber Eats right. So that's it for now. I'll leave links below to the books I discussed. So it's Ready Player 2 by Ernest Cline and The Terminal Experiment by Robert Sawyer. If you're interested in checking those out, I'll leave links below to the ebooks and to the catalog if you wanted the physical items. All right. So I hope to see you next time. Thanks for watching. Bye.